Hello everybody. Hello everyone. Thank you for joining us today. You are part of the 200 people worldwide who have registered to this webcast powered by Your Development and ActLight. This webcast is entitled Dynamic PhotoDiode, the unique light sensing technology with tunable sensitivity. My name is Faisal El-Kamasi. I'm Global Sales Support and Coordinator Manager for Your Development. Before we get started to this webcast, let me give you some basic information on this online event. You have the possibility to submit questions during all the webcast by using the Q&A box. We will answer as many questions today as we can, and for the remaining one, we will follow up with you via emails. Concerning the materials, please note that the presentations are already available and they can be downloaded from the resource list section of this platform. Furthermore, you will receive tomorrow an email with the link to the recorded webcast session. So let's start the webcast. I'm pleased to welcome the three speakers of this webcast. Dr. Zine Bouamri, Team Lead Analyst, Imaging and Display at YOL Development. Dr. Sergei Okonin, co-founder and CEO at ActLight. And Dr. Denis Salin, Director of Engineering Department at ActLight. Our three speakers will share with us their knowledge and expertise. I'm pleased to welcome, as our first speaker, Dr. Bouamri. Zine, the floor is yours.
Thank you, Faisal. Good morning, good afternoon, good evening, ladies and gentlemen. My name is Zine. I'm the team lead analyst for imaging and display activities at YOL Development, and I want to thank you for attending this. Before handing out the microphone to ActLight, I will take a few minutes to briefly introduce the 3D imaging and sensing context in terms of applications and trends, with a specific focus on mobile and automotive end markets. But first of all, what is 3D imaging and sensing? We are all used to pictures for souvenirs ever since the 19th century. But when you look at a picture, you don't really have precise sense of depth beyond the traditional cues associated with the human vision system. Absolute, relative and familiar size, elevation, texture, gradient, overlap, lighting, and so on. But a wide range of applications, as we will see a few examples afterwards, are in need of precise 3D information. And by that, we mean that beyond information on color and luminance, depth is an additional data point that is required, which would basically be the distance that can be measured from the sensor to the point in space for each pixel of the image. Then in terms of visualizing the information afterwards, as our displays are not really 3D yet, many alternatives could be envisioned, like a lookup table with color gradients, for example. And now, we talk about imaging and sensing, but what is it that we mean by that? Basically, imaging is anything that would be related to something that would need to be displayed onto a device that would then be consulted by a human being. And associated applications could be image processing or enhancement, for example. But we'll see more afterwards. Now, the 3D acquired information is not necessarily to be processed and broadcast onto a display for human eyes, but only to be interpreted by a machine, a computer, a robot. Then we would consider this as 3D sensing, and the range of applications can span very widely. It can be the ever so famous facial recognition that we have on smartphones nowadays, or advanced driver assistance systems for autonomous cars, or maybe some object recognition in manufacturing assembly lines, so on and so forth. The market for 3D sensing is here. The applications are here, and they are only expanding. To further illustrate this, we could look at an application roadmap for the years to come. As we covered just before, we are moving from a vision paradigm oriented towards imaging to a vision paradigm oriented towards sensing, and be it for mobile or automotive security. The applications that are anticipated for the years to come are all in need of 3D sensing capabilities. Now, let's address one of the markets that benefits most from 3D capabilities today, the smartphone one. Everything started from the front side of the smartphone, and everyone, of course, remembers the iPhone 10 2017 that allowed for facial recognition. With facial recognition, one can imagine providing a biometric way of unlocking one's device, eventually maybe paying with facial recognition, and so on and so forth. The trend now has been moving towards the rear side of the smartphone to further enhance capabilities. So it started with enhanced photography, but the potential is there for augmented reality applications and or gaming-related ones. And let it be reminded that technology-wise, the single photon sensitivity, SPAD technology, is starting to take over in flagship devices. And the advantages of this technology will be presented to you in further details by ActLight in a few minutes. Now, discussing a few potential applications for the mobile end markets, we can imagine a widespread for facial payment. Many examples are being seen in China, and there are discussions to bring that elsewhere, as it allows for a more secure solution that is easy to use and contactless, which, well, in the current situation that we've been living under for the past year, makes even more sense. Another application making sense, for which we have seen early examples already through animojis back in the day, or morphing, is basically, well, enhancing social network interactions that people can have with one another. Again, we are definitely in an era during which there's an increase in video calls, video interactions, vlogs, and so on, and say that enhanced interaction allowed by a 3D sensing modules is further enriching this, deepening the attach rates people have with these platforms. Now, trying to look further in the future, we can imagine, especially in this world with the lockdowns, more and more remote interactions, making things as close as possible to reality via virtual reality. When Zuckerberg bought Oculus for $2 billion, the idea of social VR was on all minds. And in order to make its compelling value proposition, the work on virtual avatars has been growing. Once again, enabled by 3D sensing for a complete, precise, detailed mapping of one's face to be as realistically represented as possible. And now from the front to the rear. As we've seen more and more integration towards the rear side of the smartphones, the major application has been on enhancing photography. Photography has become one of the most differentiating factors among flagships today, now that displays are almost all similar. Adding 3D sensing capability can bring even better photo experience to the consumer. And going beyond photography only, if we think about the hype that happened with Pokemon Go and envision the possibilities of gaming directly integrated into our day-to-day environment, 3D sensing helps. It helps on the smartphone, and this paves the way towards the future. As, well, going from virtual reality to augmented reality, the future of consumer electronics and the dream of every major OEM being this trend towards AR headsets, how we're supposed to all wear one in the streets, down the road replacing our smartphones, eventually catching this consumer dream, if compelling use cases are proven. But in any case, interacting with our environment will definitely require 3D sensing. Now, a few words about another major application that benefits from 3D sensing, so autonomous driving. We just want to remind here the audience how it's not a straightforward path from no autonomy to level 5 autonomy. These autonomy levels have become a marketing definition. It's actually more about an autonomy dichotomy, with personal cars on one hand and robotic mobility as a service on the other, both developing in parallel. And for that to happen, different sensor technologies are to be embedded in the car. Of course, 3D sensing is necessary, but it can't get the job done by itself, and other sensors are required, such as cameras, radars, to name a few. But staying on the topic of 3D sensing and LiDARs for cars, they've been around for a few years now, and they keep improving. You can see here the LiDAR technology roadmap for ADAS vehicles. The key point to note here is how nowadays the short mid-range flash LiDARs We see the rise of SPAD, an element which ActLight will address in a few minutes. And apart from LiDARs for ADAS, let us look at another trend for the automotive market by moving from the outside of the car to inside the cockpit. Driver monitoring systems will become mandatory due to the regulators. And here an example, the European Union will enforce the fact that every new vehicle sold by Q2 2022 will use these systems. And if we look at these systems roadmap, we can definitely expect an increased amount of 3D sensing capabilities to be able to blend into the smart cockpit, eventually enhancing user experience and safety. And finally, now one does not simply give a talk without sharing some market numbers. So here, a lot of information, but the key takeaways here are, we focused on two end markets, but 3D sensing capabilities and applications span across several markets. We are not talking about a dream to come. The market is already here and significant. And it is a market in full expansion. And the expected double-digit compound annual growth rate is real, with many opportunities for all actors on the supply chain. And with that, I'll give the hand back to Faisal, who will introduce ActLight speakers so that they can share more about them and what they can bring to help markets. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you very much, Zin, for your presentation. Let's now welcome our next speakers from ActLight, Dr. Okhonin and Dr. Salin.
Thank you. So, here is a summary of our presentation. First, there will be a few words about ActLight. Then we will talk about our innovation. And then specifically, we will cover single photon operation and tunable sensitivity. At ActLight, we are developing a new type of light sensor. We are IP company. What does it mean? It means that we are not selling products, but what we are doing, we are developing technology and licensing this technology typically to large semiconductor companies. Important thing about our IP that we are owner of all our IP, and we have 100% of this IP. We are not sharing this with any university or any company, so the situation is very clean. Company was incorporated in 2011. Recently, we closed our Series C round. Now, you know, when you bring new technology, first you spend some time to develop this technology. And licensing happened only when technology is good enough to be licensed. We are at a stage where this technology already licensed to leading companies. And first product should be in the market very soon. And we have ongoing project in different applications, for different applications with leading semiconductor companies. Our business model, it's pretty standard. We are licensing our technology to semiconductor companies, and they are upfront payment, license fees, and also royalties. And maybe special about ActLight, we are not one application company. Our technology is sort of platform. This technology can be used for many different applications. But still being a small startup, we are focusing on three applications. One, it's healthcare. Second is 3D sensing based on time of fly, and the third application, it's again time of fly application based on single photon sensitivity. What we are offering, a technology which can be built with standard CMOS technology. We called it embedded. This is on left side of slide. In this case, standard CMOS process is used. It's a single chip solution where circuits and detector are on same chip. So this is the advantage. It's single chip solution. It can be important when you have limited space, for example. We also have what we call standalone dynamic photodiode. It's similar to discrete photodiode. Advantage of this technology is a flexible size. We build device up to 1 centimeter. One square centimeter, and also small size is also possible. It's very low cost because technology is very simple and device can be built very fast. And also in this case, it can be built by using different material, not necessarily silicon. In this case. Can be optimized to different wavelengths. Okay, let me explain now the core of our innovation. In many light sensing application, what you have to sense, photocurrent. In this case, photodiode would be put at reverse-based condition, and when light is coming, then you have a photocurrent, and then this photocurrent can be sensed by using amplifiers, and this is how it works. The problem with this approach, standard approach, starts when light is weak or if you need very fast sensing. In this case, circuits will be pretty complex. This will increase cost, silicon area, and what's even more important, circuit will introduce noise. Basically, at low photocurrent, noise is mainly coming not from photodetector itself, but from circuits. To deal with this problem, you can use avalanche photodiode to have high output signal, but drawback is very high voltage. So it's difficult to use avalanche photodiode in portable electronics, for example. And when we started this company, the idea was create device having high output signal, but still operating at low voltages. And we end up with what we called dynamic photodiode. In this case, we are not keeping voltage across photodiode constant. We are switching this voltage from reverse to forward. And after a certain time, forward current starts. As you know, forward current can be pretty big, and it's very easy to detect the moment when forward current starts. And this is what we are doing. And what we are measuring, time when forward current starts. This time is light dependent. Actually, it's inversely proportional to the light intensity. So, and we can extract light intensity from this time. So we are not measuring photocurrent, we are measuring time and light intensity extracted from this time. Advantages of this approach is the following. Our output signal is very high, and we don't need any amplifier. Output can be directly connected to circuits. It also means that we don't have noise related to the amplifier. Still, device operates at very low voltage. So this is the main advantages. As I already mentioned, from performance point of view, what we are providing device having better signal to noise performance. On this graph, we are comparing our performance, these are points here, with the existing product on the market. And product, you can see lines here. And here we show signal to noise performance as a function of photocurrent. In case of high photocurrent, existing product, and also in our case, signal to noise performance is limited by short noise. But at low photocurrent, performance of existing products are limited by noise coming from amplifier. In our case, we don't have amplifier, we don't have noise associated to the amplifier, and we are short noise limited for any value of photocurrent. This is why, in case of low photocurrent, we have very, very good advantages compared to existing solution. Then, these advantages can be used to reduce detector size. If you won't have a small size detector but still having good signal to noise performance, you should use our detector. Or it can be also turned in a power consumption reduction in many applications, like heart rate monitor, for example. You can reduce power consumption again by using our detector. Now I let Denis to continue on single photon operation.
Thank you very much, Sergei. Yes, I will in a few moments present the specific application of our DPD detector in the single photon domain. I will first, before entering into the technical detail, I will introduce the topic with a small video clip that we produced that explain our single photon operation and the associated advantages of the DPD, especially the fact that the sensitivity is tunable. So let's start the video.
Today, machines look at the world in three dimensions. For example, smartphones can scan the scene of our living room to produce a three-dimensional image and then place our most desired object in it. So far, so good. But with increased ambient light brightness, the 3D sensing performance gets worse. To solve this problem, ActLight invented the Dynamic PhotoDiode, a unique low-voltage, small-size sensor with tunable sensitivity. How does it work? Let's have a look at the demo together. Here we see the device sensitivity tuned on single photon and the distinct reading in low ambient light conditions. Now the ambient light has significantly increased and, with the device sensitivity still tuned on single photon, the reading becomes more difficult. Here we have tuned the device sensitivity to 3 photons by adjusting the polarization voltage on the photodiode. And, with the same high ambient light as before, the reading has become clear and distinct again. ActLight. Light sensing reinvented.
So this small video clip was to introduce our single photon capabilities applied to time of flight. And now I will enter the more technical part of the presentation where I will explain how we achieve this, and I will enter in more details in this advantage that we claim, that is our tunable sensitivity. So the first thing to do when you claim to have a single photon detector is to actually prove that you have a single photon detector. How do you do this in general? Then we were able to prove this back in 2018 by just doing statistics. Knowing that our knowing that our photodetector is shot noise dominated, we know that the statistical distribution of the trigger time or trigger events of our detector follows the Poisson statistics. And according to due to this, by looking, for example, at the, on the left-hand side graph of the slide, you see that for several we have several graphs on this, several curves on this graph, and for each of them it has a different shape. Actually, it has a different expectation value and a different standard deviation. By applying the Poisson statistic out of the standard deviation and expectation value, we can actually get the number of electrons that are needed for the device to trigger. Probably you have already understood with this representation that the PD device acts as an accumulator. It accumulates a certain amount of photons, of electrons, sorry, and then it triggers with a fairly high current. And of course, the absolute limit for the detection is when you're able to trigger your device with one electron. And that's what we are able to measure here. So we push the device, and then by changing the bias voltage of this device, we were able to prove by statistics that we are having like 7 electrons needed to trigger, 5 electrons needed to trigger, 3, 2. And then the magic happens when you have 1 electron needed to trigger. At this moment, the statistical distribution of your triggering events changes completely. It becomes an exponential distribution. And this is the proof that you indeed have a single photon detector. In such case, the DPD detector behaves more or less the same as a SPAD. A SPAD will display always the same exponential statistical distribution of trigger time in constant light or in darkness. Those graphs were measured in darkness. Also, we have a pretty good agreement between the measurement and the theory. On the right-hand side of this graph, you have the theoretical expected distributions that are actually very close to what we measure. So now that we proved that we have a single photon device, we also get all the advantages of the DPD device associated. First, it works on standard CMOS. Since it's a low voltage detector, there is no need for extensive and expensive process development. It works more or less readily with available CMOS processes. And then, of course, this low voltage operation also allows us to reduce the pixel size. We do not have to take care of the very high electric field that exists in SPADs due to the high voltage. In SPADs, typically, you need at least 14 volts. Most of the time you need more, like 20, 30 volts. This creates huge electric field in the semiconductor material that you have to take in account and design your circuit accordingly. And this this has a very bad impact on the fill factor, especially at small pixel sizes. We can do it. We can have way smaller detectors with the DPD. We can go down easily to 3 micron pixel, probably. Then the most interesting aspect of the DPD is it's actually tunable. And I will spend more time on this today. The tunable sensitivity of the DPD allows to increase a lot the dynamic range of your 3D sensing system. It's well known that SPADs are extremely good detectors, but are very easily saturated with ambient light. They are actually too sensitive in many, many applications. So in, if you want your SPAD system to work in the on the outside or in some demanding applications like automotive, then you have to resort to complex system level tricks such as macro pixels and synchronicity, things like this. And this has a negative impact on the resolution of your system, actually. We can change the sensitivity of the detector on the fly, and we can adapt to the light, the ambient light situation. So in 2018, we proved that we had this single photon operation of the detector possible. But at that moment, it was only working at pretty low temperature. It was working at minus 20 degrees C. Second result that we managed to get by working on the system and also on the detector is to reproduce the same results at room temperature. We were able to reproduce the same single photon sensitivity and tunability at 25 degrees C. Afterwards, we were also able to reproduce those results at higher temperature, up to 85 degrees C. I will come back to it later in the presentation. Now I will talk in more details about the tunability. I will somehow reproduce with you the experiment that you saw in the short video clip that we showed at the beginning of the presentation, but I will enter in more technical details. So here you see the histogram of the output signal of the DPD. It's tuned on single photon sensitivity. So you see the exponential distribution of the triggering event over time. And we have added a laser pulse to the system that appears at a fixed time. In here, of course, there is no ambient light. You have single photon sensitivity. So it's very easy to detect this light pulse. There is no problem in resolving the pulse. Everything is fine. The blue line is the simulated response, and the orange line is the measured response. We also internally developed a simulator that allows us to compare our measurements with the theoretical expected values of the DPD. Now, what happens if we increase the light intensity? Here we put a strong background light, and what you see, actually, the distribution is still exponential, but is completely shifted to the left. Actually, the detector is saturated. There's a very high probability that the detector has triggered before it can even detect the laser pulse. You see here, you don't see the laser pulse at all. It's completely drawn into the ambient light. So what to do now? With a normal SPAD system, you would be very annoyed, but with a DPD detector, you actually have the possibility to decrease the sensitivity of the detector. Now, we will decrease the sensitivity of the detector, such as the detector will not trigger on one photon like a normal SPAD, but we'll have to accumulate two electrons in order to trigger. And that's what happens here. You see that now, since now we are not anymore in a single photon mode, but we're in a two electron sensitivity, the statistical distribution first changed completely. And second, we are not saturated anymore at all. It's now, again, extremely easy to detect the laser pulse. And this was done on the fly just by acting on the bias voltage of the detector. It can be shown that for every ambient light level and every laser power or laser pulse return power, there is an optimum sensitivity of the detector. We also develop simulators that calculate the optimum sensitivity of the detector. So in this first example, it's very easy when there is no background light. The optimum sensitivity of the detector is always one. The best you can have is always a single photon detector. It's what will give you the best return. Now, what happens if you have on average 10 electrons accumulated before a laser pulse of one electron? So on average, you will have somehow 10 times more light than your laser pulse. And in that case, the optimum sensitivity now, the simulator calculated that it's now 11. 11 electron sensitivity is now the optimum. You can see that by changing this sensitivity to 11, we are actually several thousand times more efficient in detecting laser pulse than if we had kept the single photon sensitivity. You can see here on the table down left the ratio between the optimum and the single photon sensitivity. Now, another interesting topic, another interesting use case. What would happen if now we have more power in the laser? What happens if we increase the laser power? So we keep the same background light, but we increase the laser power. Now in this example, there is still 10 electrons on average accumulated before a laser pulse of 5 electrons, so 5 times more useful light. And now, surprisingly, the optimum sensitivity of the device is even less than before. Now the optimum sensitivity is 13 electrons. And you can see here that the comparison in efficiency between this optimum sensitivity and the single photon case, single electron case, is even bigger than before. All this to say that the optimum sensitivity of the detector depends a lot on the condition. It depends on many parameters. And it's quite difficult to know it beforehand. That's why an active field of research at ActLight is to work on AI. So to work on artificial intelligence algorithm that would, with which you would be able to tune the sensitivity on the detector on the fly to reach the optimum sensitivity. Now I want to talk to you a little bit about the higher temperature operation. So we were able to prove that we can tune the detector and tune the sensitivity and also reach single photon up to 85 degrees C. So the next few slides are just measurement results of the same curves that you saw at the beginning of my presentation at a different temperature. First at 40 degrees C, then 60 degrees C, then 85 degrees C. What you see on this curve is that basically there's not much to see, which is good. It means that the curves are more or less the same in shape from one temperature to another. The only thing that changed is the absolute value of the trigger time. You see it on the x-axis of those graphs. Of course, when temperature increases, you have more dark current. It's an exponential dependence of dark current on the trigger time, and the whole system becomes faster. The device will trigger faster on average because of the increased dark current or dark count rate, if you want to use SPAD vocabulary. So with this high temperature measurements, I reach the end of my presentation. These are the main takeaways of the presentation. If you had to remember only 4 things about this whole webinar, those would be those 4 points. First, the dynamic photodiode is a truly innovative licensing concept. This concept has been proved by leading semiconductor companies. Concept is compelling to high growth markets. And the tunable sensitivity at pixel level is a very unique feature. Thank you very much for your attention.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you much, very much, both of you, Dr. Hakanin and Dr. Salin, for this very interesting presentation. We will now end this webcast with a Q&A session. We will answer as many questions today as we can and follow up via email for the remaining one. Okay, we have pretty much questions. So let me maybe start with the first question for you, Sergey. Can you share more about your market traction? What do you bring compared to the competition with your solution in this application? Sergey?
Sorry.
You were on mute, right?
Yeah. Sorry, guys. As I mentioned already during my presentation regarding market traction, we already licensed this technology to for healthcare application, and we have also project with leading company on single photon application. But what we are providing, what are advantages compared to other technologies in case of what I can call like normal light sensing. In this case, we are providing better signal to noise performance, which can be turned in a small size detector. You can reduce detector size, but still having good signal to noise performance. Or we can turn in a power consumption advantages. In case of single photon, as Denis just explained, our features are low voltage operation and tunability. So this is a, and here we just this feature are just unique. Okay.
Okay. Thank you. Thank you very much for the answer. We have a question, should be for you, Denis. You keep mentioning a low-cost solution. Is it mostly related to a smaller footprint, or do you also provide a process flow requiring less steps or less costly steps?
That's a pretty good question, and it's mostly... It's both, actually, but it's mostly due to the process flow and process development that is easier with DPD compared to SPADs. It's mostly due to the fact that there is no need for high voltage in the DPD. Everything happens at around 1 volt. So there is no need for special, very special implants, for very special guard rings, for special requirements due to reliability issues. So the process development is way easier for DPD, and in many cases it works readily with available CMOS processors with very minimum process development steps. Then, of course, due to this low voltage, we can have smaller pixel pitch with better fill factor. And this also reduces the cost per pixel.
Okay, thank you. Thank you for answering this question. Next question will be still for you, Denis. Other players are also working on quantum imaging. How do you gauge your attractiveness compared to them?
Yes, it's true. There are other very interesting actors in the low voltage sensing, low voltage single photon sensing. The main difference, I believe, compared to the other solutions or other proposed solutions that exist, is that with the ActLight DPD, you have very precise information on the time of arrival of the photon. It basically works like a SPAD, which is usually not the case with the other low voltage single photon sensing solution, to the best of my knowledge.
Okay, thank you. Another question for Denis. The trigger time shown was in US. How can you do time of flight light with such long trigger times?
Yes, what I showed in those graphs, most trigger times were in microsecond range. That's because it's in those cases, we were just letting the detector run in free running mode. This statistical distribution of trigger time in the microsecond range are just it's just the dark count rate, basically. It's just due to the dark current. Then, of course, if a light pulse arrives at 1 nanosecond after the 1 nanosecond after the device is put in forward bias, because that's in forward bias that our detector is sensitive to light. So if the laser pulse arrives, let's say 1 nanosecond after forward bias, then we would the detector would trigger 1 nanosecond after forward bias. It's not a problem. It's not somehow this microsecond range is just due to the it's because we were running the detector in the darkness.
Okay, very clear. Thank you. We have a question for you, Sergey. Do you have an evaluation kit available, and does it have more than one pixel sensing diode?
Yeah, and the answer is yes, we have evaluation kits. This is what we are providing to our customers as a first step. We also have evaluation kit having few sensors on the same chip. Yes.
Okay, perfect. Thank you. Maybe one more question for Denis. Can you highlight difference between DAPD and silicon photo multiplier? Example, the question is, say, expect for this high bias voltage. And another question would be, what is the measured timing resolution?
Okay, so I assume that the person who asked this question by DAPD means DPD. So what would be the difference between the DPD and the silicon photon multiplier?
Right.
So it's quite a lot, actually. The silicon photomultiplier somehow sums up the current of an array of SPADs to have an output current that is somehow proportional to light intensity. It's somehow to replace tube photomultipliers or to have something that works more or less like an APD. The DPD operated in the single photon or the few photon mode does not work like this. What we sense is not the output current. We really sense time, trigger time, which in that case is way more similar to a SPAD, to the operation of a single SPAD, actually, except that we can tune the sensitivity and not always trigger on one electron, but 2, 3, 5, 10. And the second question was?
What is the measured timing resolution?
So the timing resolution does not depend on the detector per se. It actually depends on the resolution of your time to digital converter that you use for the for your measurement. In most time of flight applications, you have quite stringent requirements on the resolution of those time to digital converters in the tens of picosecond range, usually, let's say 30 picosecond, is a type of resolution that you need on your time to digital converter, and which is what we have this range. We have that kind of resolution in the time to digital converter that we use to measure in this application.
Okay, thank you, Denis. Very clear. One more question for you. Can you expand on your healthcare application?
Yes. So our healthcare application are mostly vital signs monitoring applications. So photoplethysmography, heart rate monitoring, SpO2, the kind of application that you used on health bracelets, smartwatches, nowadays as well on hearable devices, earbuds for sports, or also nowadays you start to have the first hearing aid products with embedded health sensing, like heart rate sensing, oxygen saturation sensing. For this, as Sergey mentioned, our key advantage using the DPD is the noise, because for very low photo sensors, we have for very low photo currents, we have a pretty high signal to noise ratio because we are short noise limited, even for low photo currents, which allows us, for example, to reduce the size of the detector quite drastically, and allows us to have a heart rate detection inside, for example, inside the ear canal, which is very difficult to do with standard photodiodes. It's worth noting that in that kind of application, it's not single photon at all. It's somehow the complete other side of the spectrum. The number of electrons needed for the device to trigger in such applications are in the millions. That's how you get the very high signal-to-noise ratio, just by shot noise.
Okay, thank you very much, Denis. We still have a lot of questions, but the webcast has to now is over. So thank you very much for all your questions. We will do our best to answer by email for the remaining question. So you will soon receive email with the link to the recorded session. Also, feel free to share the presentation with your colleagues. Finally, please let me remind you that you can find all our report on our website, www.i-micronews.com. Thank you very much to Sergey, Denis, and Zin. So attendees, do not hesitate to contact us if you have additional questions. You can find our contact details on the last slides of the presentation. Thank you all for joining us today, and have a good day.
Thank you.
Thank you very much.